Good afternoon, everyone. We are glad to invite you to the series of the conversations on digital fashion communication, which is offered as a part of the program of the Master in Digital Fashion Communication, which is a double degree between USI, Università della Svizzera Italiana in Lugano, Switzerland, and Paris 1 Panthéon-Sorbonne in Paris, France. And today we will have with us an esteemed speaker, Umberto Angeloni, who will be talking on how to communicate luxury menswear, lessons learned on content creation and PR. I will have today with me here on the panel on the left, Professor Lorenzo Cantoni, who is the director, who is the co-director of the master program. And he's also the vice rector here at USI. And you will also see on the left, Umberto Angeloni. We have in the panel together with us, Sofia Iannucci, who is the class representative of the master in digital fashion communication, who will be collecting all your questions, which we invite you to ask. Then she will pass the questions to the speaker. So before I start, I will briefly again introduce Umberto Angeloni. He was born in Rome, where he graduated in economics at Università La Sapienza. Later on, he obtained an MBA from the University of Western Ontario in Canada. From 1990 to 2007, he was the co-owner and the CEO of Brioni, transforming the company from a manufacturer of quality men's clothing into a group with a leading luxury lifestyle brand identity, while reaching a turnover of 200 million euros. In 2009, he has founded the brand UMAN, and from that year until 2017, he has been the president and CEO of Caruso SPA. And he will be talking about all three cases today. So enjoy these conversations, and I would invite Mr. Angeloni to present.
Thank you, Professor Calbasca, Professor Cantoni, for inviting me, and welcome to all. I had planned initially to make this presentation a bit more real, more live, by bringing samples, fabrics, but that was not possible. So it's going to be only audiovisual. However, there are two things which will be of interest to you. One is that whatever you see tonight will be available through the university, so there is no need to take notes. No need to take pictures of the screen, which is something that normally happens during presentations. And I will be going a bit faster because then you have the chance to go back and read all the details. The other thing is that I've introduced some pauses to take questions, as opposed to talking about the whole time and then at the end accept questions. So there will be at least four interruptions during which you can present your questions related to the block that you just seen. So that will make it certainly more fluid. The topic is how important is content in the communication of luxury and fashion as an ingredient, as a factor. So I think that needs a bit more explanation to be placed into context and some of the terms used also. Every brand has a so-called identity, but what is an identity? Identity means there is a driving concept behind the brand. And the concept, however, should not be totally abstract. It should be something that can be applied, it can be used, it can be understood, it can be lived. Otherwise, it really has not much use. There are brands that make statements that supposedly explain what the brand is about, perhaps saying, I am the most expensive, I am the most luxurious, I am the best. There is a brand in Italy, Menswear, that uses the sentence, the best of the best plus one. But what does that mean? Where is the value? What is the use? How can it be applied other than perhaps expensive? So the concept is important that and should be translated into content, meaning something more tangible, livable, an experience, an event, an emotion, a product, visual. This is the content, and the content needs to be transferred to the consumer, so that in order to enhance the understanding of the brand, the loyalty to the brand, the desire to buy, the desire to belong. So that is the question, how to translate content to the consumer so that brand equity is enhanced in general. Normally, the way consumer understands and gets in touch with these notions and these facts is through media. Now, there are three types of media, as you well know. One is so-called paid media, which is merely advertising. The second one is owned media, which is the company's channels of communication. Today it could be Instagram or some other social, or Facebook. It's the brand who communicates directly to consumers almost individually. And then there is the earned media, which is the press coverage that the brand obtains on normally printed media or online media through reputable writers, journalists. And the more independent they are in the eyes of the consumer and the more expert about the field, the more it's valuable to the consumer, the notion. We will see later some statistics about that. But to get in touch with the journalists and the writers, you need a vehicle, you need a person. And these people, they are professionals, they are PRs. And it's important to have reputable, specialized PRs, and also to have a reputable face of the company, because the PR is really introducing the company and the company's spokesperson. So it's already been said that we'll be examining some cases tonight, three cases, case studies, three brands that have been related to in the role of CEO, shareholder, spokesperson, and creator of the concept sometimes, certainly creator of the content. Three brands in the field, in the market of menswear. So menswear is part of fashion, apparel, however, they are all three placed in the upper segment of this market, which is called luxury, considered luxury, the luxury segment. So the three cases will be Brioni, as it's been introduced. This is an interesting case because when I started with the company already had 40 years of life and already enjoyed a lot of visibility, but for some reasons that were no longer valid, no longer interesting or relevant. Therefore, it had lost visibility. So the question was to reset partially the concept and then to create a new totally new content. The second case, UMAN, is a case of total creation of a brand out of nowhere, therefore a brand with no archive, no market, no presence in the market. So that was a case of total creation of an identity, of a concept and a content. In this case, in the case of UMAN, concept and content were the same thing. And the third one is Caruso, is a case of a company that already had existed for 50 years, but merely as a manufacturer, selling its product in a market with other brands' names, big brands, but even retail brands. So there was no Caruso brand. In this case, it was a question of extracting from the reality of this business, its location, its capacities, its product concept, and then transform that into content. So almost the opposite of the first one. We're supposed to create content and then create a concept, a brand out of those contents. So this explains the title, and I think we need to go to the next. There's really no need to to take notes because this will be delivered to you. I've answered some possible questions. That is, are we talking about the same thing here? Is fashion and luxury? I think we answer that. I'll explain a bit more what we mean by that later on. So the presentation is about luxury fashion, specifically menswear. You already know who I am and what is the point? What are the conclusions? What is the thesis that I'm trying to deliver? The first one is that content is very, very important if you want to have earned media of quality. And it should be proprietary, original, relevant to the consumer, therefore contain information, almost educational. And it should be also, it should come from a reputational brand and brand ambassador. And the last one is that PR is the way, is the vehicle to get in touch with these writers. Then the next one, I just put some keywords that explain to you what is luxury, in my opinion, vis-a-vis fashion. Very different. A lot of them are self-explanatory, so I wouldn't have to go through them in detail. Perhaps one needs some explanation. The one that in the target section, the last one, you see there is a quality price ratio is relevant for luxury, meaning that the price of items, or goods, or services is a function of the quality. So the consumer, which is more sophisticated in this kind of category, understands and more or less knows what is the proper price of an item, given the quality, is capable of detecting quality and therefore expect a certain price. There are no surprise there. The value is there. Instead, in the realm of fashion, not necessarily so. The price is more or less independent of quality. Other factors are involved here. Emotion, celebrity association, status, prestige pricing. And then there are additional costs that go into the pricing, such as massive advertising, design fees, and so on. Therefore, there is some, and the consumer is not as sophisticated as the luxury consumer, and therefore he assumes that there is a relationship between price and quality. So he thinks perhaps the higher the price, the better the quality, but that may not be necessarily the case. Then two slides that you can analyze. This was a research made by Price Waterhouse for Caruso. I think we should concentrate on the oval, the names inside the oval, which explain who the players are that are manufactured, the brands that are also manufacturers in Italy, so made in Italy. Then the other applications on the bottom of these products can be debated. There's no need or time to go through them, but you will be able to see them at ease. And then the following one shows the relative sizes of these same brands, the Italian manufacturers. You see that the biggest one is Zegna, although about 10% is fabrics. And then there you see Brioni and Caruso, the ones that I was involved with. Just a note of caution here, because sometimes sales are not totally comparable. Depends on how much of those sales is at retail price. So a lot of these companies have a lot of stores, so they sell at full price. And normally the retail price is about three times the wholesale price. So Zegna, I think, is the highest ratio, should be around 50%. Brioni at the time, we're talking here 2012, was about a third, and Caruso was none. Caruso had no stores in 2012 yet, and therefore these figures should be probably multiplied by three or four. So this, we can now, if there is any question at the moment regarding the notion that I just presented, now is the time to make them.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for this first introductory part. I would love at least to, for a couple of seconds, if you could step back to the distinction you have proposed between luxury and fashion. In the very first line, on the one side you have put heritage and tradition, and on the other side modernity and trend.
Yeah.
Could you elaborate on those? So for a luxury brand, you don't need to change or to produce new items, new clothes, or how do you deal with this seasonality issue?
We're talking about apparel, so there are seasons. There is an evolution in materials, in fabrics, but the focus is always evolution. This word is very, very important. Fashion is more about revolution, so it means totally new and abstract, sometimes inspiration that drives the brand. Instead, luxury has in mind the needs, the function. So the form evolves as well, but only if it's of relevance, of value to the consumer, to the end user. That's why it's better to talk about evolution in the case of luxury than revolution. Is that sufficient?
Yeah.
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have a question from the students. I'm inviting Sophia to present.
So, thank you. Do you think it's more complex to start running a company, so a fashion company, ex novo, or it's easier to enter in a reality with already an identity and a specific personality?
Of course, it is easier. If we're talking about a fashion company, the challenge is always to be able to detect those inflection points when fashion changes, your consumer metrics change. So it's a question of modulating, of being aware of what's going on outside in the case of fashion. And as you know, in fashion is always very, very difficult and delicate to find the right designer. Sometimes it could be a big boom, sometimes it could be a big bust. So that's the challenge for an existing brand, fashion brand. Luxury brand is different. Luxury brand has to build upon what has already been made without canceling it, adding, improving, but not necessarily recreating everything from scratch. So now we move into the first case study, which is Brioni. Maybe some of you already know this brand, founded in 1945 very quickly, and as a tailor shop in Rome. And in 1952, it was invited to be part of the very first women's fashion show in Florence, 1952, Sala Bianca. Marquis Giorgini. And so a male model was invited to accompany the women's, and the press, which was primarily American press, was impressed. And therefore, in the following years, Brioni was invited to stage a men's show. And then from then on, which was, you know, extremely interesting, there was no such thing as men's fashion at the time. And so Brioni staged more than 300 in the next 20, 25 years, some of them very extravagantly on boats, on cruise liners crossing the Atlantic, once even on a plane, and was making very flamboyant, very, let's call it, quote-unquote, haute couture items. And, of course, the press loved it. But then what happened is that in the early 1980s, the new wave, the new designers, the actual designers, the modern designers came about, talking about Versace, Armani. And so fashion took a different route from luxury, from couture. And so suddenly there was no meaning in Brioni to be continuing his fashion shows, and therefore it had lost visibility with the press. And that's when I came in and decided that it was time. So this is, as you can see here, Brioni in the 50s and 60s had clientele was including Hollywood celebrities, but they were not celebrities like we understand them today. There are people who are basically paid to dress a brand or another, but really don't have much notion about what the way they should dress. It's just a question of economics. Instead, those icons of the time were clients. They were testimonials, but clients. They were coming in, they knew what they wanted, they wanted it to be bespoke for them, and then they became the brand's ambassadors. So when I had to recreate partially the concept, which was still the very best tailor-made suit, but that was not enough to be prominent, to be visible, to be interesting to everyone. I had to go through the archive, and I could only find three items that I could use. One was this 1964 picture of a fashion show in the Waldorf Astoria, where the whole room had been flooded, so the models were basically with the feet in the water. That was very interesting, extravagant, something very creative. The second one was this bespoke jacket that the client from California had ordered. It had 17 pockets inside and outside because he wanted to wear it when he was flying with his own plane or going on other planes. A travel jacket. Again, very interesting, but he spoke about something about the consumer, the creativity of the consumer. The other one was this poster from 1936. The island of Brioni at the time was Italian, and it was considered a luxury destination of the best, of the very best kind, like a Capri. And it was famous for the polo play. And Brioni actually borrowed or took the name, because then after World War II it became Yugoslavia, so it was completely unavailable as a touristic destination. But the halo remained, and so Brioni took the name. So there is no one called Brioni. So again, these three images spoke about one thing, spoke about luxury lifestyle. And that was the concept that we needed to express through content meaning events, communication, products. And we started to do that in a very unusual way. The books, we were not going to talk about fashion, about clothing, about fabric, about elegance, or about people. We were going to talk about what constitutes, what some of the elements of the life of our own clients, people who knew already everything they really needed to know about how to dress and how to evaluate quality, and they knew how to live well. And so we were going to dwell on those elements of lifestyle, introducing novelty, introducing ideas, possibilities, events, experiences that maybe they never had before. So the books, we decided to write books about subjects. The first one was about James Bond, the movie that we dressed in 1995. We actually dressed five subsequent movies, and we decided to concentrate on the style. We were not dressing an actor. We were dressing an icon, a legend. Legend known also for his savoir-vivre. And therefore, it made sense, and it was written by five journalists, very interesting, and edited by Flammarion. And then the Boutonniere. Every year we were issuing a new story. The Boutonniere is, no one had ever written about how to wear a flower on your lapel. I don't have one tonight, but basically I wrote part of this book. And attached to his book, there were events. We were doing private viewings of the Bond movie before the release, the official release of the movie, just for journalists. We were making events at floral shows, luxury flower shows, the Chelsea Flower Show, the Orticola in Milan, and we were giving away the books, book signings. Then I wrote a book about single malt whiskey because Italians, we discovered, are the biggest and connoisseurs and collectors of single malt whiskey ever. Again, we partnered with Macallan, considered the number one whiskey brand, to make special events for journalists and for people, for consumers. Then I wrote a book on wellness, which was becoming very hot at the time, very interesting, very something. Was taking more and more part of a person's lifestyle. And again, events at places, resorts where Brioni had boutiques, Calivolpe, Marbella, Capri, and then the Brioni Island. The Brioni Island, we revived the lure, the glamour of the Brioni Island by restaging the polo tournament, this time in partnership with other luxury brands, Maybach Cartier and Julius Baer. And then we also talk about clothing, but in an indirect way, how the tailoring school of Abruzzi developed and how our school of tailoring had been founded. And then traveling, this booklet about how to travel in style was written. And it was a special collection. There were items made according to these subjects. So everything was revolving around luxury lifestyle. It was driving design, retail stores, events, of course, books. And now this is interesting because suddenly even the journalists realized that this was a topic very, very interesting. In fact, they were invited as consumers to taste it before anyone else. You see here, suddenly in 2003, when they talk about luxury, they introduce the concept of luxury lifestyle more and more and more. Before, they were more or less present but not specifically identified as such. The luxury man becomes possibly the most important item. And here, this is research. The other one was from McKinsey. This was by a consulting company called Edelman. Every year they do in America, they do a trust barometer on different levels. And here's the question is, I believe information that I get from articles or news stories more than I believe information that I get from advertisements. This is very interesting. So it proves the point. It proves the point that earned media of quality and on target is extremely important to create brand equity. But how do you evaluate this brand coverage? There is a notion that you probably know, it's called advertising value equivalency, that transforms into money the articles, the mentions, by using as a parameter the cost of advertising for that specific space and location. But look at that picture. The journalists were inventing ways to talk about Brioni. This is the Brioni Island and the shape of a suit. So the suit was coming back, but it's part of the story. This is the Brioni polo that took place on the island. We see a short movie about that. Oops. And of course, as I said, the brand ambassador is important because it needs to be a face of the company that can credibly transmit and talk about this. This is me with Kofi Annan. The consumers were a lot of them were very power people. And they had no problem saying, I'm wearing Brioni. So they were our testimonial, real people like the actors of the time. Here's a book, made its way to the Oval Office. So if someone says, well, these books, then who gets them? Here's Bush with the book. So after 9 years of this promotion, we said now we can advertise. But we advertise using the same codes. And here's the advertisement. One picture only shot by Inés and Vinod, not showing product, not showing men in suit. not showing fabric or anything like that, simply showing an object of design, pure design, of highest technology, of superb quality, impeccable taste, a falcon, which was belonged to one of our clients, who happily lent it to us. And we used the same image year after year. There was no need. And look at the payoff, to be one of a kind. And even the retailers picked up on that, on this theme. This is Neiman Marcus with his advertisement saying that you probably spent 4 years at a fine institution learning about business. A tailor spent 4 years at Brioni to learn how to construct his suit. What a coincidence. So this is, and before we go move into the questions, I want to show you a short movie about the Brioni Island polo event.
I was very astonished to find a beautiful place. The nature is absolutely fantastic.
I am one of those who fell in love with the island. And when I first came here, that was January 2001. And therefore, any occasion, any excuse to come back is welcome.
The Brioni Islands, off the coast of mainland Croatia. This is the unique setting for the Brioni Polo Classic, a sporting and social event that offers a one-of-a-kind experience in one of the lovelier corners of the Adriatic Sea.
People come because it's beautiful, and it's something that you don't find anywhere else on the Mediterranean coast. You feel as if you're living in a world that is a throwback to another time, to the Belle Époque, to a period when things were slower, gentler, and in some ways more beautiful than they are today.
The third edition of this international polo tournament was co-sponsored by the luxury clothing group Brioni, whose founders named the company after the islands, as well as Cartier, Maybach, and Julius Baer.
This really is very, very exceptional and unique, because you really have the impression you have the island for your group of clients and the people who are here for this tournament.
Polo is believed to be the oldest team sport in the world. The first Brioni Polo Classic in 2004 marked the return of the game to the main island 80 years after its first polo club was formed. Before World War II, Brioni hosted more than 30 tournaments a year. The island was a playground for royal families, celebrities, and other elite guests. As discerning travelers increasingly look for unusual experiences, sponsors, along with Croatian officials, are convinced they are part of the answer to that quest. They are working on refurbishing the main island's small hotels, golf course, and other facilities to create an exclusive resort designed to cater to high-end clientele. At the same time, they are determined to preserve the island's quiet charm, which is one of the keys to its appeal.
Brioni, to je 14 otoka.
Croatian President Stjepan Mesic says most of the restoration and development is being planned for the mainland coast of Istria, opposite the largest island.
Brioni, we are named after the island, and therefore, as long as the island stays beautiful, pristine, upscale, or goes back to its original splendor, it all reflects very positively on our brand.
The game of polo is part of the strategy. The Brioni Polo Classic took place over 3 days of play. Each of the sponsors lent its name to a team made up of top-notch players from around the world. The four teams competed in a series of four games, battling to get the ball between the posts as often as possible and culminating in the final face-off, the Maybach Heritage Cup.
I think it's not just a sport, but it's a lifestyle. It's beautiful, it's dangerous, it's very physical. There's beautiful horses, beautiful men, beautiful clothes. As I said, it's a lifestyle.
I think it's the environment, the horses, the fast play. It's a very dynamic sport. It looks good, nice to watch.
The three-day event included recreational time for guests to explore the island, which...
So, thank you so much. That's really impressive, yeah.
This movie, by the way, you'll find it on YouTube, I think I gave you the link in the presentation. It ran first on Sky, and you can see that actually there were no clients other than the polo players, but it was only for the press. 97 journalists. We even had rented a private, huge private plane to fly them there, and the whole island was for them.
Yeah, no, that's really impressive. It's something you cannot produce. As a single person. So could you tell us something about the team you had in order to run such incredible PR event?
Well, first of all, we had 7 full-time professional PRs in 7 countries: Italy, the United States, Japan, Germany, France, UK, and Spain. Each one was inviting his top journalists to the event. Of course, we had to have a backup team, a team of people who were devoted to communication and promotion of these events. They were one after the other.
So that the core team was assuming you and about 7 people?
Or? Well, some depending on the type of event, but of course there was a communication director who was handling each one, supervising each one, and then people dedicated to each one. By the way, the polo event, the same 4 teams competed. This was in July. Normally in July was the Brioni Island, and then in January was the polo on snow at St. Moritz, same 4 teams. So there was continuity.
Yeah, more Swiss.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know we have a couple of questions from the students. Sophia. Yeah.
How important is made in Italy and Italian lifestyle in luxury menswear industry?
Made in Italy for our industry, especially the high-end industry, of course, is basically another label, a second label. A label that guarantees quality, guarantees also creativity, not just quality, because there are a lot of other places in the world when people can sew. But the way has been traditionally, the school of tailoring in Italy has developed, makes it different. But this is true in other cases, in the food, furniture, and other. Made in Italy is extremely important. I did deliver a presentation of Made in Italy in New York where it was clear the huge importance. I can tell you that every luxury brand that makes tailored menswear makes it in Italy.
No, thank you. I recently read a book titled Les Habits du Pouvoir, the clothes or power dresses. Can you tell us something about the trends or the small changes or big changes in the clothing when it comes to power people? In this case, power men, being menswear.
There is really no change because the tailored suit, the classic tailored suit, is the ultimate stage of evolution of men's costume. And men's costume is traditionally established by men of power. And when you think about the name of some of the styles, you know, Wellington boots or raglan sleeve or Windsor knot, these were the power people of the times, the nobles. They invented styles that are forever. And so think about it for a moment. Evolution means going from one stage to a better stage, to a more evolved stage, without losing what is relevant of the previous trajectory. And so if you think about the tailored suit as the perfect form, because it folds and unfolds, it basically shows your body without being too explicit. It's functional because it can be accessorized, it has pockets. It's sexy because I don't say that, but it is a man who dresses elegantly is certainly more sexy than one that undresses or dresses down. And therefore, if it's the ultimate object of the evolution of man's costume, by definition, is the most modern, the most advanced, the most trendy, fashionable.
Thank you. I know that we have some more questions, but I would love to move to the next case, and maybe we might go back to them later on if we have time.
Sure. UMAN. UMAN was a project which I undertook, developed in that limbo phase between Brioni and Caruso. And I decided that it was time to put together everything that I knew about clothing, about style, about how it evolves and how it's used. So the target was very important. The target was, I define it as the modern rich. The modern rich, you see here, I engaged an illustrator from Philadelphia, John Krause, to explain the evolution of the consumer that dresses and that consumes luxury, and including fashion, including apparel. So I use wine as the symbol. So initially, he understands only as much as he can see. Then he learns how to go through the first impression, the label, and determine the real quality of goods. He understands how to savor, how to consume luxury. If you see, the shape of his mouth is the same shape of the grapes, so he understands how it should be done. And then he becomes a spokesperson. See, as he speaks about his choices and his understanding, he creates new grapes. He becomes an ambassador of, and then ultimately his whole lifestyle, his whole being is driven by what he has learned and what he sees himself. Once I asked the consumer, "Why do you buy this? Why do you buy our product?" And he thought for a moment. I was in Manila, of all places. And he said, he was flying every year to Rome to buy. And he said, "It's because I esteem myself." That is really the answer. Having decided who the target is, the question was, to create styles that were not available, to dress up gentlemen sport, normally in their après moment, to dress up their passions, or even ethnic heritage, but made for a European consumer. Don't forget that the modern suit, the tailor suit, was invented in Europe, in England, so it is a very European style. So Europeans also are curious, especially Italians. They want to know what is the official costume in other places, and then they may bring it back, not as costume, but as real clothing, but they have to transform it. So we made a series of books, each written by a journalist, about each of the style. And then there were explanations for each style that the consumer who bought each style could keep, explaining the ethos, explaining the use and all the specialty of each one. You see here on the left, Monoi, or the right, depending on how you see the screen, is about the man, European passion about the South Seas island from Gauguin onwards. And so let's make a jacket that expresses that passion. The one on the other side has to do with, it's called Telemark, the old way of skiing, the traditional elegant way. So this is a jacket for après skiing, called the Telemark. I investigated the color and really came to the conclusion that the color blue is the most intellectual, modern, artistic color in European. So we made this book called UMAN Blue, which pairs poetry, blue poetry, and blue paintings. Here you have, the cover is Yves Klein, here you have Jean Miró and Jiménez. And then I investigated the sizes. What size, how does the industry make size 40, 42, 45? And they were really using outdated statistics from mainly the military. So they were, all these size scales were developed by measuring military or people selected at random in the streets. I instead used the target. The UMAN target was, as I described before, the affluent European about up to from 30 to 45. By the way, from 30 to 45, men's body doesn't change much. Women's body change mostly because of pregnancy, but men's body remain more or less the same. So we scanned, with their agreement, 3,500 individuals specifically selected. It was done by Alvanon, the specialist of industry, and we came up with the body of the modern rich, we called it. And you can see immediately the difference, how much more defined, more precise. And therefore, UMAN had no sizes, traditional sizes 50, 52, but had UMAN 1, UMAN 2, UMAN 3, and it was extremely... we explained all of this in a booklet called The Lexicon, which explained how the product was made and the concept it came from. Totally evolutionary. Again, I had six PR representatives in six countries who promoted it. This is a page of the book. It talks about the body, and the proportion. And the press just loved it, especially the more evolved press, the business press, the financial press, the lifestyle press. Here's the full page of the Financial Times running a story on the measure of a modern man. And here is, people were fascinated with this body because it was then made in three dimensions and not in plastic, in almost materials that represented the body, the skin and the bones. And they compared this to Kouros, you know, the typical statues of the Greek. And then here's departures, that remaking the modern man. They selected testimonials, modern rich, who would wear its style of a woman and explain why they were wearing it. And so this project lasted a couple of years. It is not extinct. It's just proceeding very slowly. There was a shop open in Milan, but then I became too involved with Caruso, but all of this is there. And UMAN never advertised because there was no point. How can you advertise a concept like this? But it gathered almost 3 million in free press coverage. So this, as I said, is how to invent a brand completely new and outside of any scheme.
Thank you. Fantastic. If you can sit here, I know that we have a few questions from the public. Yeah, Sophia?
Yeah. So Michaela asked, how do you reconcile your sensory-rich approach to brand content with the shift towards digital communication channels?
Well, communication can be either printed or digital, but then you need the real experience. Books, of course, are not real in the sense that they are to be read and not to be consumed. But the things just work in parallel, I think. You will see now, shortly, in the Caruso example, how the concept and the contents were translated into a digital format. Think about UMAN as only a two-year work, which still is there, and still 10 books were developed, each one for a specific jacket, but there's five more waiting to be published. So it's now becoming more of a cultural brand. So it brings forth culture more than business.
Okay, and the next one is from Patrick. Which PR activities would you recommend a smaller luxury brand to focus on?
As what?
Which PR activities would you recommend a smaller luxury brand to focus on?
Well, if they don't have the content, I mean, think about what luxury brands or fashion brands, even more so, have to say. So far, it's only been mainly the fashion show. And it really means having a few celebs sitting on the front row and then inviting the press and then giving the press a press release that they more or less have to follow. Unfortunately, this is the way. And therefore, even the work of the PR was not so important. Brands tended to have in-house PR because basically it says, we speak, you listen. Okay, oh, we speak and you're right about more or less what we say. So there was really not much need for a PR unless you have real intelligent content, real extraordinary content.
Yes, is there one more question?
So Matilde is asking, which kind of role do social media platforms play in communicating value for luxury brands?
Well, Online magazines or newspapers are the same as printed. They are written by journalists, professional people who are expert and write. Then the social media created these other figures such as the influencer. But again, I think now I've been reading recently that people you will see a slide a bit forward that proves the fact that consumers are becoming less and less impressed of what the influencer says because they realize that it's basically paid to do that. So it's not necessarily an expert, often not, and necessarily absolutely not independent. Independency and expertise are key to media, to written media coverage of a brand, of a product, for the consumer to believe it.
Yeah, I was really impressed. I know that you have been named as a philosopher in the field of menswear. Can you tell us something more about one of those books or researches you have done in those boundary areas where there were not yet let's say, defined clothes?
Yes, the idea was to bring here some samples and look at them specifically, but that was not possible. So sports, it was developed, there were 10, 15 styles actually. The sports, it was golf, horse riding, passions, then skiing. Passions were, for example, driving. Men love to drive cars, good cars, vintage cars, or sports cars. It was about going to visit South Seas, to be, immersed in different realities. Ethnic, think about some ethnic styles that were developed in Europe, for example, the Tyrolean look. But if you wear Tyrolean look outside of Tyrol in the winter, you look a bit odd. But UMAN says, well, there are other instances in which you can wear it, but you have to change it. First of all, it has to be blue, the common theme. And then has to be functional. And it has to have some element of its origin, of its style, but not necessarily all of it. And has to be interpreted. So there were interpretations to dress up situations where you don't want to, there is no such thing as a good après ski dressing up or après sailing, other than a blazer, which is a bit boring. All these things were developed. The after sailing jacket is called mariner, which is a more refined word than to say sailor.
And were those books and those explorations done by yourself alone in collaboration with others through, let's say, seminars, workshops?
Each book was written by a journalist expert or passionate about that specific subject. So each one knew exactly what was missing For example, in the evening, Nick Fuchs, who writes in England, very quite famous, he said there is no such thing for a man as the cocktail dress that women have in that period in between after you finish work and you go to dinner formally. What do you wear? And so we created the cocktail jacket, UMAN cocktail jacket, which was called After Dark. And there's very
we
special.
We have here, feature. Right? The book After Dark, is it?
Yeah, After Dark, written by Nick Fuchs. And each book also explains where we're coming from in the past. So it's also a lot of education here. And the intelligent and consumer loves it. And normally he is getting skills. He understands now why, and he can explain it to others. Like in the past, the father would explain to his son things about that he should know about how to live, how to dress, and how to behave, what to know, what to read. Thing is not that easy anymore. So in a way, UMAN in this particular field took that role.
Kind of a storytelling.
Yes.
But yeah.
Absolutely.
So
we move to the
yeah,
next.
I think yeah. It's time for Caruso to be.
It's time
to be
for
good
Caruso.
Italian brand.
Right. So Caruso. Again, as I said here, the company existed as a manufacturer, but not with his own brand. And so the question was how to develop the Caruso brand. But why Caruso? In fact, the company was not called Caruso. It was called Maco. Maco means manifattura confezioni, which means basically suit maker, serial suit maker, which did not pay right to the ability of this company, which is amazing. The company was founded in 1958 by a tailor from Naples called Raffaele Caruso, who migrated near Parma in Emilia-Romagna, and he specialized basically in developing styles according to the design of its clients, brands, big brands, global brands. Over the years, it had more than 100 menswear projects to develop, choose the fabric, make the prototype and then production, but with the name of the brand. It was also sold in multi-brand stores or department stores, but with the name of the store. So there was not such thing as the brand, proprietary brand. So how do we go? How did I go about it? We used Raffaele Caruso first, the name of the founder. Caruso, it's a very masculine, very easy name, very Italian. And I used some of the elements that I could see in the company, outside the company, in the territory. One was the city itself, the little town of 4,000 people called Soragna. This is where Caruso is located. And it has an interesting, very nice castle, which is an example, beautiful example of Italian Baroque, still inhabited by the prince of Soragna. And here's the prince on his motorbike. And I discovered that he's related to one of Italy's most famous legendary actor, Giancarlo Giannini, who is an in-law of the prince. So here's Soragna could become a place to promote, and the prince and the castle, because the castle speaks about, you know, beautiful Italian things. And then the opera, because Caruso brings to mind, of course, Enrico Caruso, possibly the greatest tenor of all times. And so opera is again an Italian invention and a fantastic international cultural experience. So we, by looking at the archive of Enrico Caruso, we found this picture of him in 1921 in Naples wearing a jacket that the tailor made on his design. Look, it's a very sporty jacket, but look at the way he accessorizes it. He has a pin on the tie, he has a boutonniere, he has cufflinks. You cannot see the bottom of the picture, but he has two two-tone shoes. And so we decided to make it into a new shape, and we called it the Caruso jacket. And the payoff of this brand became virtuoso menswear. Virtuoso thing evokes music, but also fine tailoring. So we started to build an archive. And then another content that came from the territory was the fine foods. Emilia Romagna is the seat of all Italian cuisine, the most famous foods from prosciutto di Parma to culatello to aceto balsamico, parmigiano. And so we use pictures where the way the food is presented is similar to the parts of the jacket. Here are the canvas that are drying to go into the jacket after they've been washed. And here the culatellos hanging. And so this became events. Events were for the press, where the food was one of the elements, also in addition to the provenance of the brand Soragna and the music. You may see that in the cups, the little plastic, little paper cups, there is a silhouette of a pig, because the Emilia Romagna is famous for his pig products. And he says sartorial cuts. So there was a degree of humor, degree of self-humor in this. But again, here's the inauguration of the New York stores. Food again, there's always a theme to show that, what are we talking about here? We're talking about these abilities, this sense, this innate, inherited capacity to do things right, to do things in style. So I invented this neologism called good Italianism. And I created this fiction entry in the Oxford Dictionary that says where it comes from. I actually took the good Italian sentence, the definition from the last book written by Hemingway, who says it's a diary of his trip around Spain to look at bullfights. And he says, because I want to travel in style, if you do want to travel in style, you have to travel with good Italians. And so I took this as a way, a theme. So Caruso, the good Italian brand. And again, it became the inspiring concept. All these three things, the opera, Soragna, and the food, could then be expressed in a new format, the fashion movie, which then was becoming hot. And maybe you can see the first clip. This is the first movie that was made. And just show a small clip of it.
William!
What?
William!
What?
I think I got a puncture!
So typical.
Yeah. It's flat. Nothing.
Okay. Well, we are here.
Soragna. Hello? Creepy, no? Do you hear that music?
Yes. You go first.
Foods, the castle, the prince, and the surrounding, the area, the countryside. and the opera, of course. And the movie was released in 2014, 2015, and I will go through the numbers. It was very successful because it wasn't an advertisement, as most of these fashion films seem to be. And then so we decided to make a second one. So to transform this into a saga. In the event you had last year about digital communication, this is Buffo. Talked about web sagas. So we decided to make a second episode, and this time to present it to fashion film festivals, which at the time had flourished because everybody was producing film fashions, fashion films. And we presented it to the best movie events, films, film festivals, including La Jolla and others. And suddenly, here it is. It won 12 awards, every possible awards everywhere. And maybe you can see a short clip. Again, the castle is always there.
Vai, Fefe.
Vorrei nel suo bel cuore, vorrei destar tuo pai del mio
peato. È un piacere rivederla.
Principe, bentornato, che sorpresa. E quando si fermerà?
Chi lo sa? Ah, a proposito, deve essere tutto perfetto.
Perfetto per cosa?
Perfetto.
Buongiorno,
ciao, Mariuccia. Buongiorno.
Buongiorno, principe.
Buongiorno. Buongiorno. Che profumino. Buongiorno.
Bentornato, principe.
Ciao, Vito. Allora, pecorino, perfetto. Parmigiano.
18 mesi.
Sorrento?
Sorrento.
Ah.
San Rossore.
San Rossore. Vai, vai, vai.
This movie, as you can see, because Giannini, by the way, calls himself the king of pesto. He teaches how to make pesto, something very simple, but exquisite. And this movie had enormous success. You saw already all the prizes, the awards it won. We'll go through the numbers in a moment. So we decided to make a third one, this time shot in Naples, with the presence of one of Italy's most famous tenors, possibly the most famous, Vittorio Grigolo, who decided to participate in this movie basically for fun. This is the end of it.
Principe, è sempre bello qua.
Ma quello è Napoli.
Principe.
Non parlare.
Sempre parole d'amore.
the costume designer for this movie was Lini Hemming, an Oscar-winning designer who dressed the five Bond movies which I had made with Brioni. This movie, and now we can go through the numbers, had extraordinary success. And so how do we evaluate these movies, the effect, the impact? Simonetta Buffo wrote in the book that to date, it is not possible to gain quantitative results that certify the level of engagement that fashion movies are able to generate. I tend to disagree. Here, for example, these are the numbers, and you can see the first movie made 322, and the second 300, the third one. But the second we placed also on other channels for seasons, a fashion channel. Now we play Entity Now. And the third one.
A good response, but look at what happened when Facebook people picked it up. Suddenly,
and it happened this year, during the COVID lockdown, people said, well, wait, you know, we want to go back to living. And suddenly made 3.5 million views in a matter of a couple of months. So this, I think, is a good figure. Look at
Zegna made one in 2014 called The Rose Reborn, a very long one, 19 minutes. But he only had since then 148,000. Isaiah, one of our competitors, made one called Tailor Made Crime, 28 minutes, and he only made 5,000 views. The sagas, Simonetta Buffo talks about sagas. He mentioned The Delivery Man. Delivery Man made interesting numbers. Armani's have tried with Film of City Frames. These are the two most successful ones, but still far from the numbers of The Good Italian. Ferragamo's made 8 walking stories that range an average 100,000. And Todd's made 2 episodes based on Italian, The Italian Dream and Italian Moment, which were basically a flop. So even compared with others, we did very well. And if you evaluate viewers' responses in terms of how many likes and for whatever good they are, but per 1,000, you see the Ferragamo, the Pradas are quite low. But for Caruso's, they scored almost 10 likes per 1,000. The fashion channel scored 10.6, and the Four Seasons, an amazing 18. The resilience. How long was movies at a certain time, fashion movies on YouTube, they drop in numbers. This doesn't happen in The Good Italian. They're still averaging 300 to 600 per day. So last but not least, when we open shops, I always chose Via Gesù, which is in Milan, the center of Milano, bordering between Via Spiga and Via Monte Napoleone. Caruso opened there. I had opened the Brioni shop there. And suddenly other brands, menswear brands, started to cluster. So I decided to launch, instead of launching the shop, I launched the whole street and started to promote Via Gesù as La Via dell'Uomo. We made a map. We called the mayor of Milan to inaugurate the street. Here's the Via dell'Uomo during Fashion Week. The journalist, again, went wild about it. Look at the press, look at the coverage. The Via dell'Uomo, the Mecca of menswear, and so on. And then Caruso, and this answers maybe one of the earlier questions, we invented the camel suit. Camel has always been an overcoat, very heavy type of fabric, together with Loro Piana, who for the first time agreed to make a combination label with the brand. We launched the Gobi Gold, we called it, the new modern contemporary camel suit, which never ever existed before. And here again is the massive press coverage that it received. So this is what it means to, this is the full page of Icon Germany, Good Italianism, and even such a person as Clinton in his Caruso suit took on the brand. Question time.
Thank you for presenting also Caruso. I really like the combination between food and clothes. Can you tell us something more about such a combination? Do you combine the taste and the touch? How do you feel the combination?
Well, the senses. What I had written here in this book, seducing the senses, both the food, the music, the clothing, a way to seduce the senses culturally, seduce the senses elegantly.
So it's kind of a synesthetic experience.
Yes.
You're looking for. And in terms of movies, when it you had to decide the plot, how long the movie or the film should be, how did you end up with those three?
They go from 6 to 8 films. Minutes, mm-hmm. because there are a lot of locations and there's music to be listened to. short fashion movies, 2-3 minutes, are mostly almost ads, advertising to a degree. The long ones don't have any success because they don't have the necessary plot. I mean, 20 minutes, 30 minutes makes no sense. We thought, because we did these movies together with Centro Sperimentale Cinema in Rome, there was a crew of 30 people shooting each movie with state-of-the-art technology and very brilliant people. And so we thought that 6 to 8 minutes is enough to make a meaningful story, which doesn't smell like advertising at all.
Yeah. There are questions,
Yeah. So which is more essential for luxury sector with the current global health crisis, gaining new audience and customers or to enforce loyalty among existing ones?
Unfortunately, some luxury brands and most fashion brands, they want always the next client. If you look back at those keywords separating fashion from luxury, the next client. What about the existing client? What about your core client? If you satisfy, my point is, if you satisfy your core client who is sophisticated and demanding, then you will surely satisfy any other. But when you adapt the brand to the less sophisticated ones, the more, let's say, the masses, then you lose the good client and you lose the luxury class. You lose identity and you lose glamour. That's why a lot of, fortunately, fashion brands, mostly Italian, not French, came up with the second line, the third line, the diffusion line, because they wanted to pull, to take new pools of consumers which were not for the brand. And then instead of, on top of having beautiful stores, flagship, they open the outlets, again to tap different customers. In the end, that dilutes the brand.
Yeah, I have quite an, don't know if it's a politically correct question, but you mentioned before the Italian style and made in Italy and now France. Should you compare the two traditions between Italy and France and the different menswear brands there? How would you?
No, there's no men's brands in France. It's all Italian. In England, you have the tailors, Savile Row, but that's custom tailoring. It's not a brand. in Italy, you have menswear. In France, you have haute couture for women. And of course, that's menswear. Quite unique. I would say, add to this, that the French authorities, the government, the politicians, they protect the brands a lot more than they do in Italy. They do really protect them from counterfeits, from any kind. And the brand owners protect their brands by not diluting them with too much brand diffusion, too much new products under the same umbrella.
And do you see any heritage in Switzerland, in Swiss brands, interesting to be
Well, mentioned? Watches. I mean, because each consumer made in Swiss really has to do with the best, the supreme technology, quality, design of watches. Okay, so that's good enough. Fashion for men is something else. Shoes, leather, design, furniture, cars. Cars is also Germany. Each country has its own specialty, expertise, uniqueness, leadership. Why change that?
Yeah. Are there further questions?
Yes, maybe another one. So e-commerce shift on sales is the current trend. How to convince the affluent menswear customers?
Well, convenience, you know, basically accessories work okay as e-commerce. You don't really need. If you already, or if you buy a thing that you already own and it's a permanent item on the brand's product range, then you might as well do it online. But pure luxury really requires a one-to-one exchange, an experience, a choice, some degree of thinking.
Yeah, that's perfect. Yeah, you know that you have a couple of slides to sum up as lessons learned.
To sum up, so content can be derived from heritage, product, culture, design, location, and communicated by way of achievement, affirmation, analogy, affinity, and so on, events, example. Content is not abstract or absolute, as we said, but it needs to be lived, it needs to be experienced. And the only way to effectively deliver it is by using PR. And it's a lot more effective in a consumer's mind than advertising. Here is an interesting table, which answers some of the question earlier. Now, look at that. The trust, this is again the Edelman Trust Barometer. How consumers trust journalists now suddenly, this is 2018, much more than platforms where influencers or other people, self-described experts, now operate. Suddenly, the good press, the good writing, the real experts are coming back. This is very interesting. Again, this proves how earned media, written by independent and expert writers, adds to consumer loyalty. Look at that. You can see it in full screen, but the purchase consideration, the affinity and the familiarity are enormously more effective with content. The last one, the light one, the one on the bottom is content. So content works a lot more than branded content, which means owned content, owned media, or user review, again, the web. So this, I think, proves again. And finally, so Brioni had a payback of about 8 million per year in press coverage, free, virtually free press coverage, with an investment of 2 million a year. The UMAN had zero investment, had 2.5 million so far in press coverage. Caruso, again, had about four to six times the investment, especially peaked in 2015 with almost 7 million with an investment of slightly over 1 million. So this concludes my presentation, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. There's been really fascinating. You have brought us along a fantastic, captivating story. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you. I don't know if this.
And with our students.
Do you have any other question at all?
No, I think
it's time.
It's time to have a pesto or something like that. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.